Okay, now in section 14-8, I want to show you how the 555 can be used in the monostable operation. The circuit connections and waveforms are shown in figure 14-25. The trigger is going to be applied to pin 2, and this is going to be a negative going trigger. Now this pin is normally held high via the 10K pull-up resistor. And the capacitor is going to be charged via RA from the VCC down through to charge the capacitor. Now the capacitor voltage is going to build up and it's going to be applied to the threshold point on pin 6. So let's go back and review the original diagram back in figure 14-20 so that we can see how this is working better. So back in figure 14-20, we can see that we're going to be applying the trigger to this point on pin 2, and pin 2 is pulled up via the 10K pull-up resistor. This is sitting at a high, so if you have a high, which is 5 volts sitting here, and if we have, again, if we had a 6 volt supply, this would be 2 volts across this one, 2 volts across this 5K, and 2 across that. So that puts 2 volts right here. So if you got plus 2 here, and you got plus 5 here, that makes this point a zero. Also, the top comparator, this point is 4 volts. And since the capacitor is initially zero, the zero is on this pin. So you got 0 volts here, 4 volts here, that makes that a zero. So we're actually in a hold position on the flip-flop. So what we have to do is assume that the output initially is a low. And we'll see why this, because in its stable state, is going to turn into a low. We'll see that after we go through one cycle. So if this is a low, this must be a high. If this is a high, the discharge transistor is turned on, which keeps that capacitor on pin 7 discharged. Okay, now back to figure 25. When you apply a trigger, and we're going to apply the trigger, which is normally held to VCC, we're going to drop it low. As long as you get below the 1/3 VCC point, that will turn on the lower comparator. Turning on the lower comparator forces the 555 into the set condition. Now with the set condition, the output goes low, which actually the real output actually goes high, though, because when the set, that means the Q goes high, not Q goes low, and not Q, remember, has that internal inverter, and you have to flip back to the other diagram, but it has that internal inverter which makes the output go high. So the output that we're looking at is actually high. Now it remains high while the capacitor is going to charge, because as soon as that goes high, the internal transistor becomes an open and the capacitor is allowed to charge up, and it charges up down through the RA into the capacitor. It's going to charge up, up, up. It's heading toward VCC. When it crosses that 2/3 point, the voltage on the upper comparator switches to the set condition. That will force the output down to a low, which turns on the discharge transistor, and the output switches back to a low, and the capacitor voltage immediately goes down to zero, and it stays at zero until the next trigger comes along. And again, when that next trigger comes along, the output pops back up, the capacitor starts charging because the internal transistor isn't open right now. The capacitor charges up, it goes from zero up to the 2/3 point, it's trying to go up to VCC, and again, as soon as it crosses the 2/3, the internal flip-flop gets set, and that forces the output down to a zero again, and so on. So now what we need to do is be able to predict how long does it take to go from 0 to the 2/3 when it's trying to go to VCC, and with that information we'll be able to determine what the TW, the time width, is of the output pulse. So to determine this, we use the same equation. And by the way, here's the time with the TW pulse width will be the width of the high output, also the length of time it takes for the cap to charge the 2/3 point. So we use the same equation we had from back in equation 14-2. Here's the time based on what the delta V and the E is. Now the delta V in this case is the distance the cap travels, which it actually went from 0 up to 2/3, so that equals 2/3 VCC. And E is the distance the cap is trying to travel, which is really VCC because it went from 0 up, is trying to get to VCC. So we'll plug these numbers into the general form of the equation. And so we put the 2/3 where the delta V was and the VCC where the E was, and this turns out to be 0.667. And when you do the math on this, you end up with the natural log of 3. Natural log of 3 turns out to be a fixed 1.10. And that's times the RAC, because we only have the RA value in the circuit. So to practice, what we'll do is look at example 14-11. What we're going to use is the 555 one-shot to stretch a 1 microsecond negative going pulse that occurs every 60 microseconds into a 10 microsecond wide. So basically we're taking the 1 micro, stretching it out to 10 micro. So the first thing I want to do is draw the waveform of this input trigger. Now it's going to be starting at 5, and we're going to, when we hit that negative going trigger, which goes from 5 down to 0, that's 1 microsecond wide. Somehow we want to stretch that out so that the output on pin 3 is actually going to be 10 microseconds wide. Now we wanted it to be a negative going, so what we'll do is actually put an inverter in the circuit so that this waveform is flipped upside down, and it'll be the output of the inverter, which is a negative going pulse that'll be 10 microseconds wide. So what we've got is, first of all, we have to do the equation part of this. So here's the general form of the equation, and we know this has got to be 10 microseconds, so the product RA times C using algebra turns out to be 9.09 microseconds. So if we choose a 0.01 microfarad capacitor and put this value in for C and then do the math on that, RA turns out to be 9.09K. So these two quantities are going to give us that 10 microsecond delay that we're looking for. And like I said before, the output's actually going to pop up high. We want it to go low, so that's why I stuck the inverter here at the output. So the end result is, here's the input trigger, 1 microsecond wide, the capacitor starts charging up. It's going to take 10 microseconds to get up to the 2/3 area, 2/3 point. And the output on pin 3 is a positive going pulse, which gets inverted via the inverter. So we get a 10 microsecond pulse every 60 microseconds. So that's our completed design. The last section in the textbook talks about, I'm sorry, in this chapter, it'll be section 14-9, crystal oscillators. And generally, these crystal oscillators are made using a quartz crystal, and this is a highly stable and accurate timing component. It is actually carved using microtechnology to form a very specific frequency out to 5 significant digits. In fact, I don't know if you can see in this photograph, this is an 8.000000 megahertz crystal. That's how accurate these can become. So when you're tweaking a capacitor or a resistive circuit with a 555, yeah, you can get a real simple circuit for building an oscillator, but the accuracy can drift based on humidity and temperature changes and so on. So when you need highly precise timing, generally we'll go to a crystal oscillator. So some of the circuits used for this are shown in figure 14-28. In the first figure, basically we're just using an HC04, two of these, with a 2 meg crystal. And by building this circuit, the output will be a precise 2 megahertz. The second circuit is using a 10 meg crystal. And by the way, any frequency within reason will work. A 10 meg, a 20 meg, or 40 meg, or whatever crystal you need, or whatever frequency you need, with these 230 picofarad capacitors. And this is a single gate type inverter circuit, the 74 low voltage CMOS compatible single gate 04, which is just an inverter. And with this, with the 2.2 feedback resistor, 2.2 meg feedback resistor, we'll get a constant 10 megahertz signal out. And finally, the last circuit is using an HCT14 with a 2 meg crystal to get 2 meg out. So these circuits, along with many others that you can look up on the internet, if you just do a Google search for crystal oscillators, you'll find several circuits like this. And we also have crystal oscillators with the circuitry all built in, and it'll just give you a package. And this package has the crystal with all the internal circuitry to give you these precise timing oscillators. Okay, so that ends chapter 14. Of course, you've been doing the homework as we go along, and the homework is broken out by section. And basically, it's a matter of looking at the example in each of the sections, going through the theory and solving the problems, and make sure you do all those for practice. Okay, that's it for now.